Juven.
Thank you.
Hey, Juven, how are you?
Normal.
Hey. I just want to make sure. So I'm sharing the full slide, right? Not the presenter view.
Yes. No. Yes.
Okay. So everything looks good on your side?
Yes.
Also on mine. Also on mine.
Okay, great.
Okay. Okay. Ready? Well,
差不多了吧.
差不多了。Yeah.
Okay. 要用中文介绍我,
both. <笑><笑> 那个邱老师在就可以了。Okay,
I'm ready whenever you are.
No problem. 恭喜恭喜，你要到实习对吗？
哦，对，谢谢。恭喜恭喜。嗯，我看一下，邱老师还没在，我确定哦，他还没来。哦，你是在等谁？
好像还是没看到。嗯。寄封信的。嗯。Okay. Maybe I just start anyway. I think he wasn't here. Yeah. Just let me introduce. All right. Today, we are very happy, and it's our great honor to have a Professor Shu-Heng Shao from Stony Brook, an Institute for Advanced Study. And he will be telling us the great adventure continued from Professor Seiberg told yesterday about the Continuum quantum field theory for fractal part two. 今天真的是非常荣幸能请到邵书恒，然后书恒是台湾之光，我们今天给他一个热烈的欢迎。Let's welcome Shu-Heng.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice introduction. Okay, so hello everyone. Today's talk will be part two of Continuum Quantum Field Theory for Fractons. It will be based on these three papers with Natti Seiberg. And this talk will be particularly focused on the second and the third papers, whereas Natti covered most of the first paper in the talk yesterday. Even though this is part two of this talk, the talk today will be completely self-contained. So if you were not at Natti's talk yesterday, don't worry, I will make sure you can follow this talk completely. And if I fail, please interrupt me with questions as frequently as possible. All right, so let's get started. Actually, before that, let me make sure you guys can see my cursor, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right, so a common lore in quantum field theory is that starting at short distances with some lattice model with local interaction, there's typically an effective quantum field theory description at low energy or equivalently at long distances. This lore is challenged by a large class of lattice spin models known as fractons. One of the most famous fracton model was proposed in this paper by Ha about a decade ago. And it has since been a very active research area in both condensed matter physics and quantum information theory. This class of lattice spin models exhibit various peculiar features that I will briefly mention in the following. And they do not seem to emit a standard continuum quantum field theory limit at long distances. Today, we will continue our exploration of non-standard quantum field theory for fractons, but today we will be in 3+1Ds, whereas the talk by Nadi yesterday was in 2+1Ds. Instead of investigating all the fracton models in the literature, the talk today will center around the XQ model. It's one of the most celebrated fractal models and is arguably the simplest fractal model. We will also discuss its related systems. And the goal of the talk today will be extend the framework of quantum field theory to incorporate these systems. So what is the XQ model? I want to give a very brief review on the definition of this lattice spin model. The detail of the definition for the XQ model will not be terribly important for the rest of the talk. But I do want to give you a feeling that this model is very explicit. You can define it in a very explicit way, and then you can go ahead and solve it either on a computer or you can try to solve it analytically. The goal of the talk today will be hopefully that at the end of the day, we can give a self-contained presentation of the continuum limit of this simple fractal model. So let me briefly review what the XQ model is. One of the earliest papers on the XQ model is by Vijay and Ha and Fu back in 2016. It's a lattice spin model. We will be working the Hamiltonian formalism. The space is going to be a three-dimensional cubic lattice. On every link of the cubic lattice, there's a spin 1/2 qubit. So on this, in this figure, this qubit is shown as a purple dot. So every purple dot is a spin 1/2 qubit. It has a spin up, it's spanned by a spin up and a spin down state. The total Hilbert space of this lattice model is then the tensor product of all this two-dimensional Hilbert space of spin 1/2 qubit. On each link associated to this spin 1/2 qubit, we have a pair of Pauli matrices that denote by X and Z. The subscript L tells you which link these pairs of Pauli operator live on. The Pauli matrices X and Z obey the standard commutation relations. So now I'm going to tell you what the Hamiltonian of this system is. The Hamiltonian is written as a sum of several of two different kinds of terms, the A terms and the B terms. Let's start with the A term. The A term is written as a sum over the cubes denoted by C. For each cube, what we have this local operator denoted by A sub C. A sub C is a product over 12 different Pauli X matrix around the cubes. So recall that the Pauli X matrix lives on the links of the cube. And for each cube, there are 12 different links. And we just multiply all this X together. This is the first kind of term. The second kind of term comes with three different species. Each one of them is associated with a vertex denoted as V. The species label is X and Y and Z. Let's talk about the Z spaces turn. It's associated with a vertex V here at the center. For each vertex, there are 6 different links connected to it. B with a superscript Z is a product only of 4 out of the 6 links, the Z polymatrix associated to it. And we take the product of the 4 Zs that are orthogonal to the Z direction. So this is the Z direction, and we multiply the Z here and here together. And similarly, you can define Bx and By. Okay, so that's a lot of details, but again, I want to emphasize that the details of these interactions is not going to matter that much, but I just want to give you a feeling that this is very explicit. Every operator is written as product of this poly matrices. And now we just have this Hamiltonian that can be represented by a huge matrix acting on our Hilbert space.
Shu-Heng, I have a question. Is this a sum of commuting projection operators?
Yes. So all this choice of the A and B turns are such that every turn in the sum commute with each other. So obviously, two different A's commute with each other because they are all made out of X. And similarly, two different B commute with each other. But the geometry and the interaction is designed in such a way that every pair of A and B also commute with each other. Okay. All right, so this looks like a very simple, naive lattice model, but it actually exhibits a lot of peculiar features. Here I'm going to mention a few of them. So let's assume we impose a periodic boundary condition on our three-dimensional cubic lattice. Let's say we have Lx number of sides in the x direction, Ly number of sides in the y direction, and Lz number of sides in the z direction. On this periodic cubic lattice, one can show analytically that the number of ground states for this lattice spin model grows exponentially in the linear size of the system. So the ground state degeneracy is given by this formula. And in the continuum limit, where we take the number of sides to infinite, this ground state degeneracy diverges. This is the first peculiarity, makes it difficult to fit into a quantum field theory framework. What is more bizarre is that this ground state degeneracy is robust in the sense that on the lattice, any small deformations by local operator cannot lift the degeneracy in perturbation theory. This notion of robustness was discussed by Nadi in great details in the talk yesterday. Usually, if you have some physical system with a huge ground state degeneracy, you might expect by adding small perturbation and interaction, you can lift the degeneracy in perturbation theory. However, this is not the case for the XQ model, and also not the case for most of the fractal models. And that's what makes this ground state degeneracy really interesting. It's something really robust, it's something really there. It's not something fine-tuned, and it signals certain topological nature of the model.
Sorry, Shu-Heng. So yes. This robustness property is also there in the Kitaev's toric code, right? It's
that's
the same?
Absolutely right.
Okay.
Absolutely right. In fact, later on, I will compare Kitaev's toric code with the XQ model in details. But you are absolutely right that the second feature is also present in the toric code. And as we know very well, in the low energy of the toric code is described by an ordinary Z2 gauge theory, which is a topological field theory.
Okay, thanks.
And finally, the third peculiarity is that there are various finite energy excitations of this lattice spin models. And these excitations have restricted mobility, which I will describe in the next slide. So you can create a local excitation here shown by this red dot somewhere in localizing space. However, no matter what kind of operator you apply to this state, you cannot move a local excitation from one position to another. On the other hand, if you start with a pair of such local excitations, one carrying opposite charges, then they can move collectively in the transverse direction. And this is one of the claims of Fenn for the fracton model, that its excitation, namely fracton, has restricted mobility. A single fracton cannot move in isolation, but two of them can move collectively. Okay, so this is a very lightning review of the XQ model and its various peculiar features. It looks pretty weird. In order to build up a continuum quantum field theory framework for it, I would like to start with a warm-up of a more familiar example that Raghu already predicted. So let me first talk about the toric code.
Sorry, Shu-Heng, I have just a primitive question. So in the single fracton state, yes, is above this ground state manifold, right? But yes, the energy gap stays finite.
So here I'm still on the lattice.
Yeah.
Then and yes, this fracton excitation has a finite energy
gap to the ground state. Okay. That's correct. And the two fracton state is like twice that energy roughly.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Later on we will go to the continuum. In the continuum, all this finite energy excitation will be integrated out. But so far I'm still on the lattice and all these excitations have finite energy.
But it's not the case that as you take the continuum limit, these energies go to zero or something, that they stay finite.
It's quite the opposite. As we go to the continuum limit, we are zooming in into the ground state. So all this finite energy excitation is infinite from the continuum point of view.
Thanks.
All right. So let's take a brief look on the toric code. The toric code can be defined in any dimension, but here for simplicity, let me define it on a two-dimensional spatial square lattice. Again, I will be working in the Hamiltonian and the space is two-dimensional. So here we are one dimension lower than the XQ model. Again, on each link, we have a spin 1/2 qubit. The total Hilbert space is the tensor product of all these two-dimensional Hilbert spaces. And on each link, we have a pair of Pauli operators obeying the standard commutation relation. The Hamiltonian is again a sum of two kinds of terms, the A and the B terms. But now the A term is associated with a plaquette with subscript P. The A term is a product of the X Pauli matrices on the four links around the plaquette. The B term, on the other hand, is associated with a vertex and is the product of the four Z Pauli matrices around the four links connected to the vertex. Again, this is a Hamiltonian where every term commutes with each other. Let's put the toric code and the XQ model side by side. They're in different dimension, but that's not a big deal here. Their lattice interaction are different, but they don't look terribly different. They all involve all these Pauli X and Z matrices. They are all the Hamiltonian in both cases are sum of local interactions. However, their low energy behavior are completely different. If you put the toric code on a periodic square lattice, the number of ground states do not scale as you increase the size of the system. In this case, it's just four. Whereas in the XQ model, as we just reviewed, it grows exponentially in the linear size of the system. The low energy quantum field theory description of the toric code is famously known as the Z2 gauge theory. The Z2 gauge theory has various different presentation. I will discuss the Z2 gauge theory in much more details later on. Here, let me just briefly say that you can represent the Z2 gauge theory as Higgsing an ordinary U1 gauge theory down to Z2. Alternatively, you can also represent it by an off-diagonal transignment theory. This arrow means we Higgs the system and going down to the low energy. This is the well-known story that I will review momentarily. The goal of the talk today will be presenting the analog of the Z2 gauge theory for the X-cube model. We will try to identify a low energy quantum field theory description for the X-cube. And the proposal is going to be what we call the Z2 tensor gauge theory. The notation is quite dense here, but I will slowly unpack them in the course of this talk. And before that, let's review the well-known story of the Z2 gauge theory for the toric code. So what is a Z2 gauge theory? There are several different ways to represent it. Here I'm going to represent it by Higgsing a U1 gauge theory. So consider an ordinary U1 gauge theory with gauge field little a mu. We add to the Lagrangian of a U1 gauge theory a charge to Stokerberg field, or Higgs field if you wish, that will denote by phi. This Higgs Lagrangian is then given by this. I'm suppressing various dimension for coupling. This is the field strength term for the U1 gauge field, and this is the coupling of the U1 gauge fields to the Stokerberg field. The coefficient 2 here means that the Stokerberg field has charge 2, and therefore later on it will Higgs the U1 gauge symmetry to Z2. So starting from this Higgs Lagrangian, we go to the low energy, and we can dualize a real scalar field in 2+1 dimension to a one-form gauge field that I denote by a hat mu. So this is the standard electromagnetic duality in 2+1D. Recall that electromagnetic fields in 2+1D has only one polarization. So under the duality, it's dual to a real circle value scalar phi. So here we trade the Stokerberg real scalar field phi to another gauge field a hat. At the end of the day, this Z2 gauge theory is represented in terms of this off-diagonal Chern-Simons Lagrangian. It involves two sets of gauge fields, a hat and a.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I'm a little confused about, I mean, if a compact, you don't have cosine, you have really the square, you know, a quadratic action here. So I don't really see the meaning of two or the coupling, strength of the coupling, if you don't have compactness.
Yeah, I think the notion of compactness in condensed matter literature in high energy theory might be slightly different. So a mu here is a gauge field. Where the gauge group is the compact U1 instead of R.
It is compact.
The gauge group is compact.
Okay.
Yeah. And the 2 here means that the Stokerberg field has charge 2, which is an integer that's consistent with having a compact U1 gauge group.
So I'm just used to writing a cosine rather than a if for a compact theory, I'm used to writing a cosine, minimal coupling rather than a square.
Certainly on the lattice, you can have all this cosine interaction, but in the continuum, when you expand things out, this will be the leading order Lagrangian.
Right. It's just, if without the cosine, I don't see how you can think of it as a Z2. How is it a Z2? In what sense is it a Z2?
Right. Like, if I go back to this slide, right, before I go to the low energy, here, A mu is a U1 gauge field, as I mm-hmm. here. So that means in the path integral, I'm summing all different bundles of a U1, a compact U1 gauge group. And the only reason I call this a Z2 gauge theory is because I couple this U1 gauge fields to a charge 2 scalar field.
I see. Oh, okay.
So in the low energy, this becomes a Z2 gauge theory. But in this Lagrangian, A mu should be really thought of as a U1 gauge field. So at the end of the day, we end up with this off-diagonal transignment theory that describes the Z2 gauge theory. But this is the presentation of the Z2 gauge theory in terms of two U1 gauge fields, A hat and A.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
There are various different ways to represent the Z2 gauge theory.
I guess what I mean is if you do it, okay, so maybe this mixed transignments is a way to do it, but yes. Without it, the way I think of U1 being Higgs to Z2 is that if you have a cosine, then when you Higgs, you get rid of the d phi by doing gauge transformation, and then you still have two phases, two states. You have a state of A equals to zero and A equals to pi, and then I really see an Ising. That's why two is very important. Yeah. But without the cosine, it's kind of meaningless because I can just absorb the two into an A. It will pop out in the Maxwell term, but there's really, I don't see a meaning of it in this presentation.
So here, as I said, we are in the path integral. We only integrate over U1 gauge fields. By saying that the little a mu is a U1 gauge field means that its fluxes are quantized in the appropriate way.
Okay.
Because of that, I cannot scale this too arbitrarily into my definition of the little a mu.
Okay, thank you.
Right, that there are several different ways to represent the Z2 gauge theory. We can alternatively represent the Z2 gauge theory in terms of discrete Z2 gauge field. But that presentation will not be terribly convenient for our later generalization to the XQ model. And that's why I chose here to represent the ordinary Z2 gauge theory in terms of a pair of U1 gauge fields.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so in this particular presentation of the ordinary Z2 gauge theory, let me just recap what are the steps we have gone through. The first step is we start with the matter theory. This is what we call the Stokerberg field phi. And the phi field has an ordinary U1 global symmetry. The global symmetry is simply shifting this phi by a U1 phase. That's the shift symmetry. Then we transition to a gauge theory where the previous U1 global symmetry is now gauged. And we have the gauge field, a U1 gauge field with little a mu. So far, there's nothing Z2-ish in the story. And finally, we Higgs the gauge group from U1 to Z2 by coupling these two systems. This is the step for our presentation, for the presentation I review for the ordinary Z2 gauge theory. Now I'm just going to follow the exact same path in the Torrey code, but apply to the XQ model. The crucial difference is in the previous Z2, ordinary Z2 gauge theory, the symmetry we started with is an ordinary U1 global symmetry. But now we are going to replace the ordinary U1 global symmetry by what we will call the dipole U1 global symmetry. I will give a definition for that in the later on, but it's a certain kind of exotic global symmetry that are present in all these fractons models. So again, we will start with the matter theory, but now with this rather exotic U1 global symmetry. Then we consider the gauge theory where this exotic global symmetry is gauged. Finally, we Higgs the U1 gauge symmetry to Z2. In this strategy, we encounter various different quantum field theories, and there are various new elements in this non-standard quantum field theory that are unconventional and unavoidable. These features are briefly are reviewed in Nati's talk. Here, I'm going to quickly go over them again. First of all, these quantum field theories are non-relativistic. In fact, they are not even rotationally invariant. The space-time symmetry will be generated by the 90-degree spatial rotation and translations. Furthermore, as already alluded in the previous slide, our quantum field theory exhibits various exotic global symmetries. And in some of its cousin models, we are going to gauge these exotic global symmetries. And finally, which is perhaps the most bizarre feature, is that this continuous field configurations in this continuum quantum field theory are going to play a very important role. So these are really some unusual quantum field theory for this unusual time. Let me start with the space-time symmetry. Recall, Nati's talk yesterday was in 2 plus 1D. Today we will be in 3 plus 1D. Our space symmetry is generated by 90 degree spatial rotations. So namely, it's the cubic group. Some of our most of our models have the reflection symmetry or parity, if you wish, but we are not going to use that in this talk. So I'm only going to restrict myself to the orientation preserving part of the cubic group, which is isomorphic to S4, the permutation group of four elements. So this is going to be our spatial rotation group. We do not have the SO3 rotation symmetry, but only the 90 degree spatial rotation. In addition to that, our quantum field theory has continuous translations in space and in time. In ordinary relativistic quantum field theory that high energy people like, fields are in the irreducible representations of the Lorentz group. So that's why we have scalar, we have vector, we have higher forms, we have spinners. All these names mean certain representations of the Lorentz group. In this non-standard quantum field theory for fractons, or at least the ones I'm going to talk about today, we only have the cubic group as our spatial rotation symmetry. So our fields are going to be in the irreducible representation of the cubic group instead of the Lorentz group. You can look up the irreducible representation of the cubic group as four on the Wikipedia page. There are five of them. This slide is full of indices. So, and don't worry if you cannot follow all the indices, it will not be terribly important. But I just want to give you a feeling that our fields will, we shouldn't call our field spinners or higher forms, et cetera. They should really be labeled by the irreducible representation of S4. Let me quickly go over these representations.
So Shu-Heng, yes. I have a question here. So yes. As Nati mentioned in his open problems slide yesterday,
yes,
one open problem is putting these, right, these things on right, manifolds, non-trivial,
right,
manifolds.
Right.
So this, I mean, if, when you do this, it looks like that's going to make it hard to put it on the
non-trivial. Absolutely. Absolutely. So I think that, so there has been quite a lot of work on trying to put the either the lattice fractal model and the continuum theories for them on more general manifolds. Not completely general one, but more general manifolds. And most of those works are about putting the theory on foliated manifolds. I have not studied, I have not analyzed this literature, but you are absolutely right. Because our space symmetry is so limited, I don't think it's possible to put a theory on the most general Riemannian manifold.
So it looks like you need something like the ability to have a reduction of structure group,
yeah,
of the manifold to SO, to the cubic group.
Absolutely. I think that's totally right.
And that could allow non-trivial manifolds, but you need to have that reduction of structure group.
Absolutely. And I think that's what that literature on the foliated manifold is about, although I have not studied any details. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I completely agree. All right. Okay, so let me quickly go over this representation for the S4. The most convenient way to think about this representation is to embed the cubic group into the SO3 continuous rotation symmetry. The trivial representation is easy. We don't have to say too much about it. Then we have a three-dimensional representation that comes from the vector of the SO3. So that will be denoted by V with a superscript I, and this index I will be either X or Y or Z. If you start with this SO3 traceless symmetric tensor that has five components, The 5 of SO3 is irreducible with respect to SO3, but it's not irreducible with respect to S4. This symmetric traceless tensor of SO3 is in fact decomposed into a three-dimensional representation that we will call 3 prime and a two-dimensional representation. The 3 prime will make an appearance frequently in the rest of the talk. It's denoted by a tensor with a pair of symmetric indices. But importantly, this pair of indices are never equal. So explicitly, we have Txy, Tyz, Tzx, but we do not have Txx, we do not have Tyy, we do not have Tzz. This is not a sensible thing to do in SO3 rotationally invariant quantum field theory, but since our theory only has the cubic root symmetry, this is a well-defined irreducible representation. The remaining part is a two-dimensional representation that we will also encounter. It carries a rather complicated indices, and I will not bother you with the details. Finally, the 1 prime will not be important for this talk. So if you cannot follow this, don't worry. If I'm going to use it, I will come back to this slide. Because our space-time symmetry is so limited, it means that we actually have more options for the internal global symmetries. So we will generalize the ordinary global symmetry to this more exotic ones, because we have less space-time symmetry that constrain the form of the current conservation equation. This exotic symmetry will be the includes a dipole global symmetry that was already alluded earlier. Okay, so these are some brief discussion on the space-time symmetry and the exotic symmetry that we will encounter later on. So now I'm going to follow the strategy to get the X cube model that I outlined before. But maybe it's also a good point to pause and see if anyone has a question at this point. All right, if not, let's just follow the plan. So the first step will be a matter theory phi with this exotic dipole U1 global symmetry. This phi theory is a 3+1D generalization of the phi theory that Nati discussed in 2+1D. It has been discussing the literature by many different people. The theory has a real circle value scalar field phi. The Lagrangian is given as follows. It has a standard time derivative terms. And it has a rather bizarre kinetic term in the space direction. The spatial derivative is quartic, but the Lagrangian is still quadratic in the field phi. In that sense, this is a free theory, and we should be able to solve it completely. Here, I included the dimensionful parameter mu 0 and mu, but don't worry about it too much. It can, similar to the phi theory in 2+1D, they can also be scaled away. The equation of motion for this free Lagrangian is this. And again, this model can be thought of as the continuum limit of the 3+1 dimensional XY Plaquette model that was discussed in this paper. But in this talk, I will not say too much about this lattice version of the phi theory. Here, I just copy the equation of motion of this model again. But now I'm going to rewrite this equation of motion in the form of a current conservation equation. First, I'm going to define the conserved Noether current as follows. The time component of the Noether current will be defined as the time derivative of the scalar field phi. The space component of the current, there are 3 space components of the current denoted as jij. Again, I is not equal to j. So we have jxy, jzx, and jyz. Each one of them is a second derivative of the scalar field phi. So far, this is just definition. With this definition, I'm going to rewrite the equation of motion in the following suggested form. I'm going to interpret this equation as the current conservation for a dipole global symmetry. The reason I call it dipole is because there are two derivatives hitting on the space component of the current. On the other hand, the number of derivatives hitting on the time component of the current is just one, as standard as in the ordinary global symmetry. Here I copy the current conservation equation again. What's novel about this dipole global symmetry is that usually for ordinary U1 global symmetry, you take the time component of the Noether current and you integrate over the whole space. In this case, it's a R3 to get a conserved charge. However, for this dipole global symmetry conservation equation, we don't have to do that. We can take the time component of the Noether current and only integrate in a two-dimensional plane of our three-dimensional total space. So here, for example, I'm only integrating over the YZ plane at a fixed point in X. In this way, I define an operator that I call Q with a superscript X, located at some point in X, but spread along the YZ plane. I claim this operator is a conserved charge. What do I mean by conserved? I meant if I hit it with a derivative, then it vanishes. Let's do that in real time. We can commute the derivative inside the integrand, and then we use the current conservation equation up here to rewrite it in this form. At this step, it then becomes apparent that every term in the integrand is a total derivative with respect to the y and z integral. Therefore, it vanishes. So in a quantum field theory with this current conservation equation, there's an independent conserved charge spread along the YZ plane at every point in X, and similarly for the other direction. This is a conserved charge supported on a submanifold in our total space. In the condensed matter literature, this is called a planar subsystem symmetry. It's called subsystem because the charge it only acts on a subsystem of the total space. Now let's discuss the consequences of this subsystem symmetry. In ordinary quantum field theory, a discontinuous field configuration leads to infinite action. For example, if you have a field configuration of phi that jumps discontinuously at some point in space, then it leads to an infinite action, for example, for an action like this. The contribution of this particular discontinuous field configuration to the path integral is zero. For the Lagrangian we are discussing here, discontinuous fluctuations are actually important. For example, discontinuous fluctuation in just the x direction is not suppressed in the path integral as long as they are independent of the y and z direction. They have finite action. This is reflected by the dipole global symmetry action that the dipole global symmetry that we discussed in the previous slide acts on the field as shifting the field by a function of x plus a function of y plus a function of z. You can easily check that this is a symmetry of the Lagrangian. Because there's such a dipole global symmetry, we have to take the discontinuous field configuration into account. In particular, the amount we shift the field by, this f of x, can be a discontinuous function.
Shu-Heng, do you have a typo here? Is it phi of a txyz?
Oh, yes, thank you. That's kind of embarrassing. Yeah, a previous version of this slide is actually written for the 2 plus 1 d phi theory. Thank you for pointing that out. It should be phi txyz. Yes.
Can I just yeah. a comment? So this is all global symmetry, so there's nothing robust about this.
No, yeah, you're totally right.
It's this only the dual of this will be robust.
Sorry, say again?
It's only if you dualize this, I guess you'll get a gauge theory. Which
well, so Yeah, so, well, let me comment it on a little bit. So I think on the lattice, the lattice version of this model is absolutely not robust. The continuum version of this model is robust in the sense that Nati described. But again, this is not going to be the main player. Well, it's not going to be the goal of the talk today. As you already alluded, at the end of the day, I hope to get to a continuum theory for the XQ model. And that model is robust in the continuum as well as on the lattice.
Can you just remind me, I missed Nadi's talk, unfortunately. In what sense is this robust in the continuum?
Right, so let me say that very briefly. So for that, we have to ask, what are the local operators in this continuum quantum field theory? So phi itself is not a well-defined operator. This is because phi has a periodicity to pi. On the other hand, e to the I phi is a good operator. Mm-hmm. So naively I can, or cosine phi if you wish. So you can, naively you can add to the Lagrangian by such a cosine phi interaction and destabilize the phase. Mm-hmm. But if you look into, whether or not such a perturbation by local operator will actually destabilize the phase depend on whether the operator is relevant or irrelevant in the renormalization group.
Oh, I see. Okay, thank you.
And as it turns out, these operators are irrelevant in the continuum. Okay, and the model is natural in the sense that it is natural because of this dipole global symmetry. Here, the notion of naturalness was discussing Nati's talk yesterday, and it means that we have included all the turns up to the appropriate derivative orders that are compatible with the global symmetry. Okay, so this is the first step towards building up a continuum theory of the XQ model. And we have talked about matter theory. This theory is not a fractal model. We are slowly building our way towards a fractal model. Second, in the next step, we're going to turn this U1 global symmetry into a U1 gauge symmetry. So in the previous phi theory, we have this conserved Nernst currents, J0, JXY, JZX, JYZ. Now we're going to couple it to a dynamical gauge field that denote by A. There are four components of the gauge field. One is the time component, and the other three are in the space component. They have the following gauge transformation. The time component of the gauge field is in the trivial representation of the S4, the cubic group. So let me just rewind a little bit. So as I said, since our quantum field theory only have S4, the cubic group, as its spatial rotation symmetry, we're going to label our fields according to their S4 irreducible representation. The time component of the gauge fields is in the trivial representation. The space component of the gauge fields is in this 3' irreducible representations. They have this gauge transformation. The gauge transformation for the space component of the gauge field is a little bit funny. It contains two derivatives. And that originates from the fact that this gauge field comes from gauging a dipole global symmetry. From this gauge transformation, we can build gauge invariant electric and magnetic fields. They are also in certain irreducible representations of the S4. I'm sure by now you have forgotten what are the irreducible representations of S4. Again, it's not going to be terribly important, but let me just show you real quick that this 1, 3', and 2 are the irreducible representation of S4 that appear in this gauge theory of the dipole symmetry. So now we can write down a pure U1 tensor gauge theory for this dipole symmetry. This theory has been discussed in the literature quite extensively by many people. And the Lagrangian for this pure tensor gauge theory is schematically just a sum of the electric field square and the magnetic field square. Very similar to the Maxwell theory. Gauss law of this pure tensor gauge theory takes this following form. It's rather non-standard because it has two derivatives. This model is actually a gapless fracton model, but it's not going to be the, okay, so this is one of the other fracton model. It's different from the XQ, but we will get there soon. This concludes our second step of the strategy. And now we are finally ready to go to the XQ model, to go to the continuum limit of the XQ model. We're going to Higgs the U1 gauge symmetry we had in the previous slide down to Z2. So we start with the Higgs Lagrangian. This part of the Lagrangian is the Lagrangian for the pure U1 tensor gauge theory of A.
Excuse me?
Yes. Shu-Heng? Yes.
Before you go to Higgsing, okay. I would ask, do you know whether this U1 gauge theory is stable?
Is sorry, excuse me. Yeah, so let me comment on that. Again, I think there's a subtle order of limit issue between the lattice and the continuum theory I describe here. Let me start with the lattice. On the lattice, I believe there are monopole operators. So on the lattice, there's no magnetic symmetry for the U1 tensor gauge theory. So there are monopole operators you can add to the lattice Lagrangian and destabilize the phase. This is very similar to the 2 plus 1D ordinary lattice U1 gauge theory. It's very similar to Polyakov's mechanism. So on the lattice, it's not stable. In the continuum, where if you take the limit where we have a, if you start with the lattice and you take the continuum limit such that the physical size of the lattice is fixed, but you shrink the lattice spacing, at the same time, take the number of sides to infinite. If you take this limit, the continuum theory you get will be stable. And the reason it's stable or robust, to be more precise, is again because the monopole operators in the continuum actually creates a very heavy state, very much similar to the older 1 over A state that Nati discussed yesterday. But again, this is kind of, this model is kind of just appears in our path building the XQ model.
So this part is very different from the usual 2 plus 1D QED3? If you add a monopole, even in the continuum, you immediately gap out the phase.
Yes, that's absolutely right. Yes.
I see. And is this peculiar feature for the 1 over A effect that changes the things?
Changes the thing. Well, it changes the robustness of the continuum theory.
Yeah, it's because of this 1 over A effect.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's because when you carefully analyze these modes carrying the magnetic symmetry, you find that their energy is of order 1 over A.
Okay, but suppose I just have a lattice model where I fix A and increase the number of sides, then what happens?
Then I think the lattice model in that limit is not stable because the monopole operator you can add to the lattice Lagrangian will destabilize the phase. This is a phenomenon actually described in this paper by Shu and Wu back in 2000.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you for the question. All right, so any more question? If not, I'm going to move on to Higgsing the theory down to Z2.
Yeah, question. Shu-Heng, what is the difference for this tensor gauge theory between U1 and R?
That's an excellent question. And as I think the reason you ask is because I deliberately ignore all these global aspects in the course of this talk. So just as in the ordinary gauge theory, whether or not the gauge group is a compact U1 or R will affect various global aspects. This includes various flux quantization and also whether or not you have a certain magnetic symmetry. Now here, it doesn't seem that the difference is that important, but later on when we go to the continuum theory of the X cube model, all this global aspect will be important for our analysis of either the spectrum or the quantization of the coefficients in our model.
Okay, so basically there is some, when you sum in the path integral, you also impose some quantization conditions.
That's right, that's absolutely right. That I didn't discuss in the talk so far, but some of them will be important later on in the talk.
All right, thanks.
All right. Okay, so now let's try to Higgs the theory down to Z2 and really get to the main player of the talk today. So we start with the pure tensor gauge theory, whose Lagrangian is just a sum of electric field square and the magnetic field square. And we couple the gauge fields to a Stoltenberg or Higgs field, phi. So A is the field in our step two, phi is the field in our step one. The two here means that the Stoltenberg field carries charge plus two under the compact U1 gauge group. Starting from this Higgs Lagrangian, we go down to the low energy, just as what we did in the ordinary Z2 gauge theory. And we are going to perform a duality on the field phi. The phi is actually dual to another gauge field that denote by A hat. The A hat is different from the gauge field A. It has its own complicated indices that you don't have to worry about. They are in their own S4 irreducible representations. You can think about this duality as a generalization or analog of the electromagnetic duality in 2 plus 1D between an ordinary gauge field and a real scalar field. So at the end of the day, after going to the low energy and dualizing the scalar field phi, we can rewrite the Lagrangian for the Z2 gauge theory in a BF type fashion. By that, I meant the following. The Lagrangian involves two kinds of gauge field, and it's always the gauge field of one kind, here shown by A hat, multiplied by the field strength of the other kind. So it's a little bit, it's a BF type or Trans-Simons type Lagrangian. Let's just put the ordinary Z2 gauge theory and exotic 3 plus 1D Z2 tensor gauge theory side by side. So in both cases, we started with certain Higgs Lagrangian. We go to the low energy and we dualize the scalar field. In one case, the scalar field is dual to an ordinary gauge field. In the other case, it's dualized to a very novel exotic gauge field. And we end up with a Trans-Simons type Lagrangian. And I claim this is the answer. This is the final Z2 tensor gauge theory. Here I suppress a lot of the indices. You can put them back in. And this Z2 tensor gauge theory was first discussed in this paper by Kevin Slagle and Kim back in 2017. It involves two sets of gauge fields, A and A hat.
Before you go into that, could you go back one slide? Is there an easy way to see that the number of degrees of freedom in this funny dualization? It's not obvious to me that you have on the left-hand side of that dualization with the A hat.
No, it's not.
Scalar field degree of freedom.
Yeah. So let me actually, it's easier for me to count the degrees of freedom on this slide. Okay, so let me do that for you. Okay, it was absolutely not obvious to you because I didn't give you any details. So let me say a little bit here. So there's a gauge symmetry for each one of the gauge field. The first line we have already discussed. Now to answer Greg's question, let's look at the second line. This is the gauge transformation for the A hat gauge field. Again, I suppress all the indices. Now, A0, the time component of the A hat gauge field, is in a two-dimensional representation of S4. Its gauge parameter alpha hat is in the same two-dimensional irreducible representation of S4. Okay, so now let's count. We have five off-shell degrees of freedom for the A hat gauge field. Gauge parameters is in the two. there's an associated Gauss law that will also be in the two. So the counting is 5 minus 2 minus 2, and you end up with 1. So that's why this A hat gauge field has 1 degrees of freedom. And that's why it's dual to the scalar field theory phi. Does that answer your question, Greg?
Yes, thank you. They're very clear.
Okay. Sorry, why did you subtract 2 twice?
So let's recall that in the ordinary gauge fields in 3 plus 1D, we have 4 gauge fields to start with. The gauge degrees of freedom, the gauge parameter, we have only 1 gauge parameter, but there's an associated Gauss law constraint on the phase space. So the counting is 4 minus 1 minus 1, and indeed we have 2 polarization for ordinary 3 plus 1D gauge field. You have to count it twice because whenever there's a gauge symmetry, there's an associated constraint.
Okay. I see, thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so this is the answer. The Lagrangian is a transignment type Lagrangian. You can either write it in this way, or you can integrate by parts to write it as the gauge field of A multiplied by the field strength of A hat. I didn't define B hat and E hat here, but there are some similar combinations of A hats making the engaging barrier. All right. It's straightforward to generalize the story to Zn tensor gauge theory. You just replace the 2 by n. But suppose someone just hands you this Lagrangian without telling you where it comes from. How do you know the coefficient here has to be an integer? From the construction, in the construction from Higgs's certain U1 gauge theory, it's clear that n has to be an integer because the U1 gauge group is compact. So it only has integer representations. But suppose someone just hands you this Lagrangian, and with all the A and B being, with all the A and A hat being U1 gauge fields, you can show that this coefficient, this level, has to be quantized by a large discontinuous gauge transformation on a Euclidean 4 torus. And the relevant gauge transformation is actually the one that Nati discussed yesterday. Here, theta is the Heaviside step function. Okay, anyway, this is the presentation of the model. Now let's ask, does this do the job? Does it reproduce all the peculiarities of the XQ model that I reviewed briefly in the beginning of the talk? Let's go over that. So let me remind you what are the peculiarity of the XQ model. First, it has a very large ground state degeneracy that diverges in the continuum limit. Second, this ground state degeneracy is not an accident, it's not a fine-tuning phenomena, it's something very robust. Third, the excitations of the model have restricted mobility. I will return to the first peculiarity towards the end of the talk, and I will start with the second, the robustness. Small perturbations at short distances in the UV lattice models by local operators typically become relevant local operators in the long distance quantum field theory. In our case, the long distance quantum field theory is given by this transignments type Lagrangian. The equation of motion of this Lagrangian sets all the local operators to zero. To be more precise, it sets all the gauge invariant local operators, which are the electric and magnetic fields for A and A hat, to zero. So this is a theory, this is a continuum quantum field theory with no local operator at all. Since there's no local operator at all, there's nothing you can add to the Lagrangian to destabilize the phase. For this reason, this Z2 tensor gauge theory is robust. The robustness is very similar to the transignment theory for the ordinary Z2 gauge theory. And hopefully this answers Raghu's question in the very beginning. So this is how the continuum theory sees the robustness. Next, we move to the restricted mobility.
Oh, sorry, What happens to the monopole is, so even in this case, it is still unimportant?
The monopole that we discussed a few minutes ago was for the U1 gauge theory of A. Here we have already Higgs the theory down to Z2. In the U1 gauge theory of A, there are local monopole operator in the continuum Lagrangian. In this Z2 version, there's no such operator anymore. All the local operators are set to be zero. And this is the main reason why this model is robust. Okay. All right, so now let's talk about the next peculiarity, the restricted mobility. So how do we explain the restricted mobility of the finite energy excitation on the lattice? Well, first we have to clarify that this Z2 tensor gauge theory that we discuss here is a low energy limit of the XQ model. So it only captures the ground state of the XQ model in its Hilbert space. The finite energy excitation, such as fractons that exhibit restricted mobility, are no longer part of the Hilbert space of our Z2 tensor gauge theory. Instead, they become defects of the Z2 tensor gauge theory. So instead of talking about states in our Z2 tensor gauge theory, we will now represent the finite energy excitation, such as fractons on the lattice, in terms of Wilson defects in the low energy Z2 tensor gauge theory. Our Z2 tensor gauge theory has two kinds of gauge fields, A and A hat. Let me start with A. A has the following gauge transformation, and let's try to write down certain gauge invariant Wilson defects from this gauge field. This is also very similar to the defects that Nati discussed yesterday, but now we are in one dimension higher. The simplest kind of defect is to integrate the time component of the gauge field from past infinity to future infinity at a fixed point in space. This represents a single fracton that's stuck in space and cannot move. The reason it cannot move is because we do not have the AX or AY or AZ component of the gauge fields to turn it around. By contrast, if you start with a pair of fractons with opposite charge, say separated in the Z direction, then you can turn such Wilson defect by using the AIJ components. So this is the motion of such a configuration. The Z direction is pointing outside the slide. This is the XY direction, this is the time direction, and a pair of fractons can move collectively along a space-time curve C in the TXY space-time. This is the C curve. And the motion of this collective movement is captured by this Wilson defect, which is gauge invariant. Such a collective motion is called a planon in the condensed matter literature because the curve C can freely move on the XY plane. So to summarize, the restricted mobility of the fractons, which are represented by Wilson defects in the Z2 tensor gauge theory in the continuum, is explained by the gauge invariance of these defects. Similarly, we have Wilson defects built out of A hat. These are the other set of gauge fields we have in the Z2 tensor gauge theory. The defect comes with three different species, each associated with a spatial direction, X or Y or Z. A single such defect of species X, it can move, but it can only move along the X direction, not Y and Z. So it can move in the X direction in this TX space-time. Its movement, its motion is captured by this Wilson defect with C hat a space-time curve in TX. And since it can only move along a line, it's called a lineon in the condensed matter literature. There's a similar planon for the lineon, but I'm not going to discuss it here. So the cast of the characters in the XQ models are the fractons, which are Wilson defect of A, and the lineons, which are Wilson defects of A hat. They are very similar to the anions of the ordinary Z2 gauge theory. Before I address the third peculiarity, I would like to say a little bit more about this defects in the Z2 tensor gauge theory. Let's look at the Wilson defects of A. For example, this defect that describes the motion of a pair of fractons moving in a space-time curve C in T, X, and Y. This is not a topological defect because the motion of the defect is stuck in the Z direction. I cannot freely move the defect in the Z direction without violating the gauge invariance or without changing the correlation function. So this is not a topological defect. But it's kind of quasi-topological in the sense that I will describe now. Recall that in the Z2 gauge theory, the equation of motion sets all the gauge invariant field strengths to zero. In particular, it sets the magnetic field B to zero. And because of this fact, this Wilson strip defect is topological in the deformation of this space-time curve C. So this Wilson defect is topological in T and X and Y, but not in Z. So in a sense, it's a quasi-topological defect. Similarly, the Wilson defect for the lineon of the hatted gauge field A hat, is also not completely topological. This defect is constrained to move along the Tx space-time. It cannot exit that Tx space-time. It cannot move in the Y or Z direction by itself. But since the hatted magnetic field vanishes, the Wilson defect of A hat is actually topological in deformation of this space-time curve C hat. So it's topological in T and X, but it's not topological in Y, Z. So again, it's a quasi-topological defect. We can now discuss special cases of this defect in the case when they are at a fixed time. When the defects are defined only at a fixed time, they become operators that act on our Hilbert space. They are not local operators. They are extended in certain spatial directions. If you take the Wilson defect of A and fix it at a given time, then you have a strip operator. The strip is a direct product between an interval in the Z direction and a closed curve on the XY plane. In fact, this Wilson strip is identified as the symmetry operator of a certain Z2 dipole global symmetry. To be more precise, this is not quite a dipole global symmetry that we discuss in the phi theory, but it's a close cousin of it. Similarly, you can take the Wilson defect of A hat and fix it at a given time. Then it becomes a Wilson line operator, given by this. And this is identified with as the symmetry operator of another exotic global symmetry of the model, which we call the Z2 tensor global symmetry. So the Wilson operators at a given time, they generate a certain exotic global symmetry of the model. And similarly, we have operators in the other spatial directions. Now that we have discussed the symmetry operators, we are finally ready to address the ground state degeneracy of the model. In the continuum limit, the ground state degeneracy is infinite. So as a conservative person, you can say, oh, that's good enough. I got the infinity that I want. But to really see the exponential growth in the linear size of the system, you have to regularize it on certain lattice. It doesn't have to be the same as the original lattice you started with, but it's just some regularization. On the Hilbert space, as we said, we have a pair of global symmetry operators, and they obey a non-trivial algebra between them. In fact, we have not only one pair, but this many pairs of Z2 tensor global symmetry operator and Z2 dipole global symmetry operator. Each pair obeys a Heisenberg algebra. By that, we meant, by Heisenberg algebra, we meant an algebra of two elements, A and B, and AB anti-commutes, and they both squares to one. This algebra famously does not allow for a one-dimensional irreducible representation. Its minimal representation is two-dimensional. So having such an algebra acting on your Hilbert space enforces a ground state degeneracy. The fact that we have this many pairs of such algebra means that the ground state degeneracy is 4 to 2 to this power.
But you're assuming they're commuting algebras.
They're, yes. So when I say pairs, I mean they commute, each different pairs commute with each other. This might not be obvious from the presentation, but in the paper you can work it out explicitly that there's a choice of the basis such that different pairs commute. Okay. All right. So this huge ground state degeneracy is explained by the non-trivial algebra between two exotic global symmetry. At this point, I should remind you that there is a very similar phenomenon in the ordinary Z2 gauge theory. In the ordinary Z2 gauge theory in 2 plus 1D, namely the low energy limit of the toric code, you have a Z2 electric one-form global symmetry here and a Z2 magnetic one-form global symmetry here. They also obey a non-trivial commutation relation. If you phrase it, it's related to the braiding between the anions. The non-trivial commutation relation in that case can be interpreted as a Tuhuf anomaly, a mixed Tuhuf anomaly between the electric and the magnetic one-form symmetry. And indeed, the fourfold ground state degeneracy of the ordinary Z2 gauge theory can be explained by this mixed Tuhuf anomaly between the electric one-form and the magnetic one-form global symmetry. Similarly, here we have a non-trivial algebra between the two exotic global symmetry. So to recap what we have discussed, there are three peculiarities of the XQ model that I outlined in the beginning of the talk, and they have their corresponding quantum field theory explanation in this Z2 tensor gauge theory. The ground state degeneracy is explained by the exotic global symmetries and their non-trivial commutation relation. The robustness of the XQ model is explained by the absence of local operators in the Z2 tensor gauge theory. Finally, the restricted mobility is explained by the gauge invariance of the Wilson defects.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
It's me.
Yes.
So in the usual 2 plus 1D or any d-dimensional Z2 gauge theory, a Z2 toric code. Yes. As you mentioned, there is a electric operator that could be a line operators, and there is a total space time d minus two-dimensional magnetic operator when they are linked.
Mm-hmm.
You can detect.
Right.
So how about the case you just mentioned? Is there some configuration also for the two operator you introduced for A and A hat?
Yeah.
Is there some configuration?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So when you say link or braiding in 2 plus 1D, that's a configuration in Euclidean space-time.
Correct.
So there's a special case of braiding and linking that you can phrase at a given time. At a given time, those linking and braiding becomes the non-trivial commutation relation of the operators defined at a fixed time. So So that yes. is precisely the non-trivial algebra that I describe here. Now you can ask a more advanced question that whether I can describe certain braiding or linking configuration of my Wilson defects that are extended also in the time direction. And I think the answer is yes, although we have not fully analyzed it in our papers. But I think the answer is yes, and I have some preliminary thought about it. Yeah,
okay, thank you.
Not a very explicit answer, but I think the short answer is yes. And that's reflected in this non-trivial algebra of the operators at a given time. Okay, so now let me conclude this talk. So in this talk and also in Nati's talk yesterday, we extend a framework of quantum field theory to incorporate fractons. This quantum field theory at low energy, they capture the universal aspect of various lattice models. They're very non-standard. There are various new elements in our quantum field theory, including the limited space-time symmetry, exotic global engaged symmetries, and most importantly, the discontinuous field configuration play important roles in all our analysis. The low energy limit of the XQ model can be described by a Z2 tensor gauge theory whose Lagrangian takes the form of a transiemence type. And as we just discussed in the previous slides, it captures all the universal peculiarities of the XQ model. There are various future directions. For example, we need a better and more rigorous treatment of the discontinuous field. There are many other fractal models that we would like to fit into our framework of quantum field theory. As I vaguely alluded to earlier, and it was also a question raised by Vladimir yesterday and not his talk, there also seems to be Hoof anomalies of the exotic global symmetries in these fractal models, and it will be interesting to analyze them in details. Also, one can generalize the setup to manifolds with boundaries and analyze the edge modes of various fractal models. And lastly, and perhaps this is one of the most exciting directions, is that now that we have a framework of quantum field theory for fractons set up, we can just run the machinery and try to generate new models from this framework. And hopefully we can learn something new and exciting. All right, so I think there are many more to explore. I would like to stop my talk here. Thank you very much. And everyone, please stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you, Shu-Heng, for the great presentations. And we have time for questions.
Hey, Shu-Heng. Yeah, Shu-Heng. I have two questions about group theory.
Yeah.
So you mentioned the renormalization group several times, and usually we associate that with a conformal invariant fixed point and a classification by group theory of relevant, near relevant perturbations. And I can see part of the conformal group of your theories, but I wonder if you've worked out what the full conformal group is.
Yeah, so that's very interesting. We have not. Indeed, there's the space-time symmetry we have utilized so far is only the S4. But indeed, in various of our models, we did notice, and some of them are also discussed in the literature, that there are certain kind of conformal or scaling symmetries. But they are quite non-standard. And yeah, the short answer is that we have not analyzed them. And I think using this additional space-time symmetry might help us understand the model better. For example, it might constrain the correlation functions in our models, just like how the conformal symmetry constrain correlation functions in ordinary CFT.
Yeah, my second group theory question is, you could imagine doing this on lattices with different space groups than the cubic group.
Right.
And I would imagine you'd then get a much more complicated zoo of models in the continuum. Have you thought about that at all?
Yeah, we are actually analyzing some other lattice model with different space group symmetry. And yes, indeed, the group theory detail will be different, but and there are, in some models, there are also some new physics, but I think this framework hopefully can still work. Yeah, indeed, there are many different models to be analyzed. Here, we have only analyzed a few.
Could I take up a little more of Tom's question there? Because yeah. I had the same question, and it addresses the very last point on your last slide. Right. I mean, so it looks to me like what you're, you know, the class of models you're describing is choose a finite subgroup of the rotation group, mm-hmm. choose some representations, and write a quadratic invariant mm-hmm. action.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's the space of models. So, I mean, are those, but that seems too cheap. I mean, those aren't all going to have fracton behavior, right? So there has to be something more. It's not just, let's choose some representation. Let's choose a finite subgroup of the orthogonal group. Let's choose some representations and write an invariant quadratic action.
So some of the models that you write down this way, yeah, they might not be fractonic. Furthermore, they might not be robust. Right? For example, the model that the ZN model Nati discussed yesterday is not robust. So indeed, the class of models that one can generate from this framework, not all of them will be fractonic, but maybe some of them will be, and I think that would be interesting to classify and investigate.
All right, let me put the problem this way then. So given a finite group G in the rotation group and a representation not necessarily reducible of G, and an invariant, a quadratic invariant of that representation, you get a field theory of your type.
Not necessarily. I think so.
Really, that's what I was saying. I mean, and then my question was going to be for what G and what R. Are you going to have fractonic behavior?
Let me give a little bit more detail. So the data you provided is definitely needed, but not all such data give you such a theory. So let me add a little bit more details. So you pick a point group, in our case, S4. You pick some representation for the gauge field. But then you also have to tell me what are the gauge transformation for this gauge field, right? And this gauge transformations will determine the scaling dimension of this gauge field. And you have to make sure the Lagrangian.
Okay, good. So there's a third piece of data.
Yeah.
Which is your gauge symmetry.
Yeah. But I totally agree with you, Greg, that I think this setup is very combinatorics. You can just start with some data and try to cook up certain transignments type Lagrangian and see what you get. Of course, there are various subtle global.
Why did you say transignments? A priori, all you need is some quadratic invariant action.
Oh, sorry. Maybe I shouldn't call it transignment, but BF type, right? I'm aiming for a certain Lagrangian that takes the form that a gauge field multiplied by the field strength of the other guy.
So the idea is it has to be BF type or it won't be robust?
So not all BF type Lagrangians are robust. But I think most of the robust models, most of the gap robust models that I know of always omit certain BF type presentation. I don't have a theory.
That's my other question. So you have some kind of funny four-dimensional version of a Chern-Simons action. Mm-hmm. So is there a five-dimensional analog of a Pontryagin density here?
That's an excellent question. I think I thought about it very briefly. I don't have a good answer at this point. There might very well be.
Shu-Heng, you gave a...
Can I ask a question?
Excuse me. Sir, you can ask, but there are three people raised their hand in a row. So if you want, maybe raise your hand so I will call. It's more fair. Please.
So I had my hand raised. So where am I?
That's right. You will be the second one. So Nat first, actually. Nat from Hover.
Just related to this talk about group, point group, I was wondering, like, how important is the whole group, the S4 to this discussion? Say, like, if I started with a lattice model where I explicitly broken the cubic symmetry, when I go to the field theory, what would is S4 still emergent here, or do you need
that really depends on the model. Yeah, so here we just analyze one particular model where on the lattice you have a S4 symmetry, and in the continuum you still have that that S4 symmetry, but not bigger. In other models, if on the lattice you already break the S4, then in the continuum you may or may not have a bigger symmetry, and that has to be analyzed individually. I don't have a completely general answer. I think it's really model dependent.
Uh-huh. But I could imagine just breaking it completely and.
Yeah.
But in the continuum, what can you say then if you break the space group completely?
Well, then we probably don't have such a powerful. So if you break it completely, I mean some other models, and in the continuum, there might still be a quantum field theory description. It's just that I couldn't organize my fields in this under the spatial symmetry. I don't think the spatial symmetry is that crucial for the analysis, but it's certainly convenient and helpful for us to organize our analysis.
Nice, thank you.
Okay, so there are maybe three or four people. Leo will be next, and Manchen next, and I think Peter Kovchuk next, and then Joe Wangha. So the next one will be Professor Leo Rosikowski from Colorado. Go ahead,
Leo. I just wanted to make a comment. First, a comment and a question. The comment in the earlier discussion about the data that you need. You know, if you take one step back where you're writing the global, when you're representing these theories in terms of the global
right
description, there, yeah. In addition to the lattice structure, you need, you know, spatial symmetries. You're also imposing dipole symmetry, some kind of a higher moment symmetry.
Yeah.
Which is what then translates into your, determines your gauge transformation and the once you gauge the symmetry.
Yes.
Would you agree with that? That's the additional data.
So I think there are several different ways to, first, maybe I should say, I don't want to make a general claim on if there's a classification, how to classify everything. We haven't thought about that really carefully. We have only analyzed these few models in great details. But then, as to how to generalize to other models, I think one approach is what I was discussing with Greg and Tom, that we can directly start from the transignments or BF type Lagrangian at step 3 and try to build up some combinatorics. But you are also absolutely right that if you following the logic in this talk, we can start from step 1 and try to build it up. They should be equivalent. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree.
So my question is, it's like a different direction. Is, you know, so you talked about these discontinuous fields when you're in at the level of these the global symmetry models from which you derive the so those are, you know, that's a, what do they look like? You didn't talk about these discontinuous field configurations on the gauge theory side.
I did not, but it's in the paper. Can
you comment on that a little bit? What do they look like? What are they?
Right. So I can talk about either in the U1 case or in the Z2 case. Let me say a little bit about the U1 case. So first of all, in the gauge theory, we not only have discontinuous gauge field configuration, but also the transition function of a gauge field can be discontinuous. So you can have some bundle of our gauge fields with discontinuous transition function, and there might be discontinuous gauge field configuration living in that bundle. And such configuration will realize the electric and magnetic symmetry of the underlying continuum gauge theory. They also give rise to non-trivial electric and magnetic fluxes, and they turn out to be very crucial in, for example, quantizing the coefficient of the Zn gauge theory once it takes it down to Zn. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in our papers we have, yeah, in fact, we spend really a lot of details analyzing this discontinuous configurations and their consequences. But indeed, I didn't cover them in this talk.
But these are, is there anything left over of them? This is just in the gaugeful configuration, or actually when you impose a gauge, or when you look at the gauge invariant quantities, there's gauge invariant quantities also.
Yes,
discontinuous configuration.
Yeah. So in the U1 gauge theory, even the gauge invariant field configuration, such as the electric and magnetic field, can have some discontinuity. They can have some delta function, to be precise.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Next will be Professor Manchin from Yale University.
Hey, Shu-Heng.
Hey, man.
Fantastic talk. So I want to ask you a question about the U1 part. I mean, I know that's not the main point, but you said that the U1 version of a theory with what you call the dipole global symmetry is actually stable in the continuum limit. And that relies on the limit where you actually take lattice cutoff A to zero together with a usual thermodynamic limit where, you know, system size goes to infinity. But if I fix A,
I think the theory, the limit that I was discussing, maybe we're talking about the same thing, but let me just clarify and make sure we're on the same page.
Yeah, that'd be
so the limit sure. I'm taking, so I start from the lattice.
Yes.
I'm taking the lattice spacing to be very small.
Right.
And I take the number of sites, which I call capital L, to infinite.
Okay.
But I want to keep the product of capital L and the lattice spacing fixed. So the physical size is kept fixed, but the number of sites is taken to infinite, at the same time shrinking the lattice spacing. Mm-hmm. So that's the limit I have in mind.
Okay, so under that limit, the theory is, the monopole operator is irrelevant. Is that what you are?
That's correct.
But on the other hand, if I choose a limit to be, say I fix the lattice spacing, but I take the size of my lattice, the number of sites to infinity, then you're saying you get a totally different result.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. In fact, in our paper, we wrote down a formula for the energy of a state created by this monopole operator. And from that formula, you can explicitly see this phenomenon. So the formula depends on the lattice spacing A, and it also depends on the physical size. And by staring at that formula, you can take those two different limits and obtain different results.
I see. So you're saying that the scaling dimension of this operator actually depends on how the limit is taken.
Yes.
But then there should be some dimensionless thing, or that the ratio of these various things, or?
Yes, there is. Well, so there are also various dimensionful couplings involved in the formula.
Okay. Just wondering how A and L would enter, but I'll check your paper for that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Next one will be, I think, Peter Kovchuk from IAS. Peter.
Thanks. Shu-Heng, just a short question. You mentioned the description of, when you're discussing the ground state degeneracy, you said that you need to introduce some regularization to see how the number of states grow. But do you have a description for the Hilbert space directly in the continuum limit?
Well, so the number of Hilbert space, the number of states, so first of all, the Hilbert space only has ground states. So every state has the same energy. And in the continuum limit, there are simply infinitely many of them. The dimensionality of that Hilbert space is infinite.
Sure, but is there some useful description for this infinite dimensional Hilbert space?
Useful description I can provide is that if you regularize it with some lattice, with certain lattice, then you will see this many number of ground states, and these states are in the minimal representation of this algebra.
Okay, thanks.
Next will be Zhuang Ha. You here still? I think Zhuang, the Haskell Ha was here. Maybe he's gone.
Hi, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, here. Okay. Great.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Sorry. I wrote my question on the chat room. Oh. So there is a unitary that maps the ground state of X cubed model to a copy of itself at a coarser scale, and in addition, there is a stack of toric codes that goes along all the directions. Can you see that in your field theory?
I didn't quite hear the first part, but let me first answer the second part, maybe. Mm-hmm. So if I understand you correctly, so I know in the literature there are constructions of the X cube model from coupling layers of 2 plus 1d toric code and add mm-hmm. coupling and then going to the low energy. We couldn't quite see that explicitly in our formalism. I think that's something interesting to analyze in the future. I think similar question was also asked in Nati's talk yesterday. Now, there's another related statement, which is that when we do RG on the lattice for the X cubed model, as you do one step of RG, you can see that you have to add one more layer of the 2 plus 1d toric code to the X cubed model. So that there is a continuum version for that statement, and it's basically it's somewhat related to the slide here, but I didn't quite discuss it in the talk today. It amounts to, so once you look into the effective theory of the continuum C2 tensor gauge theory, you can see, and with certain lattice regularization, you can see this additional layer of the 2 plus 1d toric code as you increase the number of sites. And you said there's a unitary transformation taking the XQ model to another model?
On the explicit lattice with the fine, with the overall large but finite degrees of freedom, you can find an explicit unitary that maps the two ground spaces. One ground space is the original X cube model with, say, lattice size being L by the other one is L over 2. The L over 2 side, you have several copies of the toric code completely decoupled.
So we have not really compare that description on the lattice with our continuum field theory description in details, but I actually believe this feature is captured by our analysis of the continuum theory. There are some formula that look reminiscent, but since I have not studied the corresponding lattice statement in great details, I couldn't say for sure, but I believe the answer is yes.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Any people from the audience have questions? Any comments, questions? 任何问题或者是评论? Shu-Heng. If you cannot understand what I said earlier, it was Chinese Mandarin, in case people don't know.
Well, I think there's a question in the chat. Dong asks, what happens if you consider triangular lattice? By the question, do you mean what happens if I put the X cube model on the triangular lattice, or if I consider some other lattice model on the triangular lattice? So again, we have only analyzed the X cube model and its related cousins in details at this point. There are certainly some other interesting models on other lattices that we have not analyzed so far. And for those models, they have different space group symmetry and the details of the analysis will be different.
So if I may, I have another question.
Yeah,
please.
In front of me. So the X cube model in 2D is unstable.
Right.
There are no fractons in 2D once you go to discrete versions, discrete models in the lattice.
Yes.
In 3D, they're stable.
Yes.
Maybe Nadi discussed it yesterday and I missed it. What do you see in this continuum
So you can see that very explicitly in this formalism. Let me briefly say that. I don't have the formula in this slide, but I can say it schematically. So this is the Lagrangian for the 3+1D X cubed model. And you see it involves two kinds of gauge fields. And the equation of motion sets all the local operator to zero. So I don't have any local operator. And that's why it's robust. In 3+1D. In 2+1D, the Lagrangian takes a different form. So in Nati's talk yesterday, the Lagrangian he end up with take this following form. Can you see my writing?
Yes.
So there's a scalar field that he called phi tilde multiplied by E and with the 2/2 pi coefficient. Now, so the players in the 2+1D XQ model is different from the players in the 3+1D. In 3+1D is built out of two gauge fields. In 3+1D is built out of two gauge fields. In 2+1D is built out of a scalar field and a gauge field whose electric field is called E. So in 2+1D you have a local operator phi tilde. And that's why it's not robust, because you can just add this operator, to be more precise, the cosine of this operator to the Lagrangian and destabilize the phase.
But what happened to the argument, the equation of motion argument? So you look at the equation of motion and isn't the equation of motion E equals zero and phi equals zero or d phi equals zero?
Yeah, the equation of motion from here only says that, the d phi or certain derivative of phi tilde is zero.
I see, but phi is non-zero.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. And here doesn't work because phi is gauge invariant, but here A is not gauge invariant. So that's why.
To be precise, phi tilde is not literally gauge invariant. It's a circle value scalar field. So it has the 2 pi ambiguity. So that's why you have to dress it with cosine. And right, once you dress it with cosine, that's a good operator.
Right. It's a good operator. Okay. I see. Thank you.
Yes, so you can see this very explicitly in this framework. Mm-hmm.
Any more questions and comment? If not, I think we should thank Shu-Heng again, Shao Shu-Heng. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for the great talk. There will be additional talks in the future about fractal, also from condensed matter people. So if you have interest, please take a look on our website and you can check the upcoming talks. Actually, there will be two in June and I think one in the end of May. So there are at least three more talks on fractal. Thank you very much.
All right,
thank you. Good.
Thanks.
Thank you. So when are you going to Stone Rock?
The plan is fall next year, 2021.
Oh, not this year.
Not this year. It will be very difficult for me to move physically this summer, right, given the circumstances.
I see. Okay, well, have a good time in IAS.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, bye.
Bye.
All right. I'll consider it.
OK, Julian, 谢谢啊。
对对对，谢谢。OK。OK。他到处挖了。啊？他到处挖了。OK。
Okay, 好，那那 take care， 我们之后之后再联络。啊，先这样了，拜拜。
拜拜，谢谢。Thank you.